Good evening and welcome everybody to round number 9 of the GT Pro Series 2019. Tonight at Cleveland at the Burke Lakefront Airport. My name is Sebastian Gerhardt and I will be your host tonight for this race and well, we're looking forward, hopefully, for a very interesting round because we are, of course, at the airport track. And tonight, we guess top speed will be the main key for being in front of the other drivers. And we already see or saw in the practice session some differences in the standings. So don't be fooled by what you can see in the tower on the left side of the screen at the moment, because everyone started the qualifying session and there will definitely be some differences since a lot of drivers have weight in their cars, a lot of the fast drivers have weight in their cars, and that will keep them from reaching their top speed on those very long straight parts on this track. There are several chicanes, as you can see here. The first one, or in this case, we are coming up for that first start and finish straight and then hard under braking into the hairpin. There's a Viper coming back onto the track. I think that's the car of Lars Novak who ran wide. So then coming up for the next chicane, a right and left-hander. Switching from one rolling field to the other one. And then there's another left and right hand chicane. Still pretty quick. And it's like a long going right hander. So just being straight for a second and then turning into the next 90 degree right hander. Keeping the momentum into the next one. And then we are on that long straight. But you can see on the left is the pit entry, and then there's that final chicane again. Oh, and Glatter missed the apex there, running very wide, but still crossing the line for his first timed lap. 1:11, but already beaten by his teammate Kevin Jaeger. And especially that last hairpin with those tire, not walls, but tire tower, that small one in the center. It's pretty dangerous because those won't move when you hit them. They are like concrete and they definitely will destroy your car as soon as you hit them. And I saw that quite some time in, or for a few times during the practice session. So this could be a factor during the race as well, to be more careful at that part of the track. Here you can see that the two small parts of tires in the inside of the corner. And especially in the chicane, they are very, very close to the track. And I hope to see it from that inside camera, but most of the drivers entering the pits already. I guess that's because they're running on very low fuel. Oh, let's take a look from here. Marco Domen entering the first chicane. Turn number 3 and 4 coming up to 5 and 6. It's so hard to see the corner entry because it's so flat on this track. Now let's see how he manages to get to that final chicane. And there you can see how close they are going next to those tires. To those concrete tires. Marco Domen makes it up to 5th position in his second timed lap. The two drivers that will be really in trouble during that race, and that's Martin Ulrich. And that's a really hard setback for him, because he will have a drive-through penalty and he has to serve them in the first 15 laps of the race. And considering that we only have lap times about 1 minute and 10 seconds, maybe it will be during the race more like 12 seconds with all the fuel in the cars and maybe different tires. But still, very, very short lap times, and those 15 laps will be over very soon. And not only has he to serve a drive-through penalty, he also has 75 kilograms of additional ballast in his car, because he won the last race on the NOLA Motorsports Park. So he took a victory, and now it will be totally the opposite for this race. If you look at it realistically, I'm afraid he will end up maybe even behind the top 10. Jürgen Minch also carrying a lot of weight, having 70 kilograms in his Ferrari. Then the championship leader Alex Bräutigam, he's carrying 60 kilograms and still running in fourth position, at least during the qualifying at the moment. Though I'm afraid he will be caught during the race, and still taking pole position. And that's always the same with Alex Bräutigam. You're wondering, how does he manage to be that fast with all that additional ballast? So he has to be incredibly fast throughout the chicanes. David Jundt in a second at the moment, he's carrying 10 kilograms. That's quite the difference, and still can't beat his teammate. Not the direct teammate, to be precise. He's running for the Black Hawk Racing White team together with Kevin Jäger, while Bräutigam is driving together with Sascha Glatter. And Glatter, to my surprise, just at the moment when I was wondering where he is, he takes pole position. So now it's Glatter in first. And with Kevin Jäger in fourth position in the starting grid, at least at the moment, there would be four Black Hawk Racing cars in the first two rows of the starting grid. And to be honest, hopefully there will be some other drivers to beat them, at least during the qualifying, so there will be a bit of a mix-up at the start. And Carsten Schulz was pretty quick during the practice session, but he is still missing to set a proper and really fast lap time for himself in this qualifying run. Not carrying any additional weight in that Ferrari, while there's Silvio Strigler behind him. He also isn't carrying any weight. The teammate of Kim Strohmann finished 13th in the last race. So I got the late information by Danny Ter Martin that he won't join the race tonight. That's sad, because that would be his second race in a row he won't participate in. And he has shown us that he's a pretty quick driver. So there's Kim Strohmann. Finished in 9th position in the last race, so he's one of the drivers without additional ballast. The first 8 drivers in the series, they get additional ballast. Due to their positions in the last race, and it's always made new for the next race, so you're not collecting weight throughout the season. It always is only used by the positions you had during the last race. And that means Kim Strohmann without any additional ballast, but as soon as he would make it onto that 6th place, he is current, or he was in the qualifying run, just put down to 7th, he in this case would get 20 kilograms additional ballast. Currently that's André Geider carrying 20 kilograms in his Dodge Viper, just running in 15th position. I'm afraid he won't be too happy about that. He was hoping for a better position, especially you would expect that Viper to be very quick on a track like this. Danny Tam Martin just telling me in the YouTube chat that he's charging for trying to beat Black Hawk Racing. Well, as you see their performances, it makes sense to charge maybe for more than one race. And then try to make a move against them. Sadly, at the moment, we don't have updated championship standings, but at least I can tell that Alex Bräutigam, the current champion, is still in the lead of the championship, on the current championship, and as well is the team Black Hawk Racing White, with Kevin Jäger and David Jund ahead of Black Hawk Racing Red, with Alex Bräutigam and Sascha Glatter. And I think we can be pretty sure that the championship title in the Drivers' Championship, as well as in the Team Championship, will be entirely fought between Black Hawk Racing drivers. They are just enormously quick, and currently no one else found a way to beat them. Of course, there were several winners throughout the season so far, but in an overall perspective, Black Hawk Racing is just too strong. And it's not the first season where they are showing very impressive performances. And while I was talking, Kim Strohmann took the lead in the qualifying run, and only 6 minutes to go, so that's not that much time for the other drivers, for Glatter, Jund, Bräutigam and so on, to get that pole position back. Marc-Oliver Thiel with a very impressive 5th position, but he crashed into the wall after in the final chicane, and now he has to make his way around this track on 3 wheels. Has to be very careful, because you have to come into the pits and then you can go out for another timed lap. You're not allowed to press escape and set the car back into the pits and then just try another one or another time. If you crash and you have to put the car into the pits by pressing escape, you are out of the qualifying, so you're not allowed to leave the pits again. Oh, and that was kind of a surprise. He hit one of those small light poles there on this track. So they are really hard as well. Good to know. Hopefully the drivers will be careful when they somehow run wide. You can see those small pins with their lights on. So obviously they are very dangerous as well on this track. Marco Albertil, he needs to hurry if he wants to set another lap time for himself. Kevin Jäger in 7th position, then it's Carsten Schulze. Well, that should be an unpleasant surprise for him, seeing that he was very quick in the practice session and then kind of reality kicks in when the really fast drivers take out their qualifying setup and just beat him down to 8/10 of a second, considering the pace of Kim Strohmann. Of course, we can't be sure how much kind of slipstream also cause or does cause those lap times. If you're lucky or maybe clever and doing some teamwork, you of course can get into the slipstream of your teammate, especially on this long straight. Then the hairpin, it might get you a few miles per hour and maybe gives you that important hundredth of a second more for your lap time. At Burg Lakefront Airport, this racetrack here in Cleveland, was used during in IndyCar events, and the last race was in 2007. No GT racing on this track in reality, and currently no racing in general on this track. Luckily there's sim racing, so you can still have some action on this track today. Well, let's see if Carsten Schulze can improve his lap time. No, stays in 8th position. Kim Strohmann still on pole, and he parks his car in the pits, and that means his qualifying run is over. Martin Ulrich, with those 75 kilograms additional ballast in the car, he will be starting from 9th, most likely. Still, there are a few drivers who can beat him. Marco Domin, obviously with a pretty quick second sector. And he makes his way up to 6th position, so Martin Ulrich down to 10th, and he was slowing down, so I don't think we will see another lap time by Martin Ulrich. Lars Novak in his Viper, and that looks a bit strange. I think that's the shadow from that helicopter that's crossing ahead or above. So don't know where that comes from. So let's see what the second sector time looks like for Lars Novak. And he is also there with an improvement in his second sector. There's a Black Hawk Racing Corvette slowing down, and Novak is entering the pits, so no more improvement for him. Felix Heinen, he's still going, and he doesn't make any attempts to come into the pits. So this it will be his final try through the last chicane. Some slight drifting there, entering the corner. But I don't think there will be any improvement by Heinen. No, he stays in 13th position. There's Conny Näslund. He stays in 14th. Martin Ulrich still going. He was quick in his first sector, but it will be 10th for him. And then just Marco Drummen and David Jund still on the track, as well as Timo Hartmann. Oh, and Marco Drummen drifting into... that was a nice move through turn 8. But this will cost him a lot of time. So I'm pretty sure he will stay in 6th. David Jund entering the pits as well. And that means our qualifying is over for tonight. And I think it's for the first time that we see Kim Strohmann starting from pole. So the Peak Line Motorsports driver, he will be very, very happy about that result. The problem will be, can he stay there during the race? I was told before the race that you can use almost any strategy tonight. So running on hard tires without changing them, running on medium tires without changing, as well as running on mediums and changing the tires. Just depends on the way you drive, and in the end there won't be many differences in lap times or the final result. But hopefully we will see a lot of moves trying to overtake when coming up to the hairpin, or maybe to the chicanes. Trying to use the slipstream. Sascha Glatter in the pit lane after exiting the paddock. That's a very interesting part in R-Factor 2, because very often if you're in a practice or a warm-up session like this, the cars are really packed in the paddock, so you sometimes really have to drive a long way to make it into the pit lane and then exiting the pit lane onto the track. We've seen that several times throughout the season by now. And that's another example for that nice small feature. While most of the other racing simulations, the cars are always parked right at the spot on the pit lane. Often they don't even support that kind of additional parking space in a practice or warm-up session. And now let's see when Glatter will set his first lap time, what the difference is between that lap time in the qualifying run and now with those hard tires and a tank full of fuel. As you can see, Glatter running on the hard tires, so with the white markings on the side, while David Jund behind him, he's running on medium tires. So he should be quicker early on in the race. But if Glatter stays on those hard tires in the race, he most likely won't stop for a tire change, just do some refueling. And I'm pretty sure they will do this in this race because of those many high-speed of full speed parts on the track, which of course consumes a lot of fuel. The quickest lap time was a 1:10.134 by Kim Strohmann. And Sascha Glatter was just 66 thousandths of a second behind that. So let's see where he will end up. It's a 1:13.066. So we are talking about almost 2 seconds slower than in the qualifying. Letta only carrying 30 kilograms in that car, so it's not much of a surprise. He is quicker than his teammates. Though David Jund behind him, he's only carrying 10 kilograms and he has the medium tires. So I'm a bit surprised that David Jund doesn't try to attack Glatter. On the other hand, Glatter, well, it's Sascha Glatter, one of the fastest drivers in the GT Pro Series. Still, Marc-Oliver Thiel, he's quicker as well as Joris Scheepvaart. So that's a bit of a surprise, seeing Joris Scheepvaart so quick during the warm-up session. He will start from 18th in the race. So if that's his pace in the race, I wonder where we will find him when we see the checkered flag after the race. Lars Novak in his Viper now. Current quickest driver in the warm-up. So it's obvious the results might be a little different at the end of the race as it looks in the qualifying. So here we are, starting into that race, everyone waiting in the paddock, but this time of course the cars will be warped into the starting positions on the track, and then we will have a rolling start, so you can still wait a little moment before we are underway and racing in that ninth round of the GT Pro Series. It's the eighth season. And there will be still some races to enjoy. Next round on April 2nd, and there will be a vote which racetrack should be driven, and I don't think that vote is open by now, so still not sure which track we are about to expect for that 10th round. And then two more races, we will see the race on the Norris Ring, so that will be very, very interesting on that very, very short city racetrack in Nuremberg, and the final race will be on the Misano World Circuit in Italy. That will be in May 14th. Well, and then we will be looking forward for a 10th season. Maybe that season will start a bit earlier than it did with the 9th season. It took almost a year after the 7th season to come back with the GT Pro Series, and still most of those drivers from the 7th season, they waited patiently for a year, and even though they were racing in other series until the GT Pro Series started. They all came back. Like good old friends meeting again after 1 year not racing against each other. But of course everyone would like to have a new season much earlier than after a 1 year break. It's always wonderful to hear those whining sounds of the gearbox. Kim Strohmann leading the pack onto the rolling start. And whilst we're at it, we were just shortly fix everything for the replay. Here we are. Kim Strohmann, then the three Black Hawk Racing Corvettes, Sascha Glatter right next to Strohmann, and it's David Jundt, Alex Bräutigam, and the first green flashes car, that's Marc-Oliver Thiel in the green and white Ford GT, followed by both the Team Coupler Sim Racing Ferraris, Marco Dohm and Jürgen Münch, Kevin Jäger in the next red, white and black Black Hawk Racing Corvette. Then it's the third driver of the Team Coupler Sim Racing drivers, Carsten Schulze, and on the top of the screen you can see the gray, red and black Porsche 911 driven by Martin Ulrich, who has to come into the pits in the first 15 laps of this race. And I already heard some parts bumping, that's a bit strange, but now we're waiting for the green flag, and Strohmann will be on the inside for the first corner, so better position for him. And here we go, and a very good start by Kevin Jäger and a bad start by Marco Dohmann. He's already overtaken. Oh, Jürgen Münch almost crashing into Marc-Oliver Thiel. He gets a bump from behind from his teammate Carsten Schulze, and Kevin Jäger was sent wide into the grass. Kim Strohmann staying on track, keeping the first position. Sascha Glatter already fighting against his teammate David Jundt, and Glatter stays ahead of David Jundt. Alex Bräutigam in fourth position takes the position from Marc-Oliver Thiel. And there is some trouble on the track, if I'm not mistaken. I thought so, but everyone is still going. So three of the Black Hawk Racing drivers now in 2, 3 and 4. Marc-Oliver Thiel fifth. Then it's Jürgen Münch, who passed Marco Dohmann pretty early. Kevin Jäger going wide, and then it's Silvio Strigler. And something must have happened to Carsten Schulze, and that's not too long ago, Silvio Strigler. So now in the top 10 ahead of Martin Ulrich, he kept his 10th position, followed by Lars Novak and Felix Heinen. Novak in the Viper, trying to make a move against Ulrich. No, he stays behind, final chicane. But the gloves already came off in the first corner. Novak breaking into the first corner. First lap is over, and there are that's those small things, so that's okay. I was afraid to see some car parts flying, but that didn't happen. Marjan Kodermann already in the pits. He also has to make a drive-through penalty. And now I wonder what happened to Carsten Schulze. So let's take a look at that again. Oh, and there, this happened already. So maybe we can find the reason here. Yeah, that was the attack move. And then it's Martin Ulrich, Kevin Jäger, some contacts there. Oh, and I think Schulze slowed down. So that's the reason. Schulze slowed down because he thought it was his mistake sending Kevin Jäger out into the grass. And it was the gentleman's agreement by him to giving him his position back. And that's now why Carsten Schulze dropped down to 18th position. Still a bit weird, but well, that's the current situation. And now he's trying to make a move on the outside against André Geider. But that didn't work out at all. Jo Schäfert, he gained to position up to 16th behind Matthias Weber. But we are looking further up the grid. Because there's Kim Strohmann trying to escape from Sascha Glatter. Which, if he does it right, should work, because that Ferrari is lighter than the Corvette of Sascha Glatter. Glatter carrying 30 kilograms additional ballast. And he is fighting with David Jund. Glatter racing for Blackhawk Racing Red, while David Jund is racing for Blackhawk Racing White. So they have the same team badge, but it's not the exact same team. And now he takes second position from Glatter. And that helps Alex Breutigam to close in, followed by Marc-Oliver Thiel and Jürgen Münch. Jürgen Münch is maybe trying to make that move against Marc-Oliver Thiel. Oh, running very, very close to those tires on the inside. It's obvious how hard it is to enter those corners properly when you're close behind someone, because the corner entry is so hard to see. And Sascha Glatter now in trouble, because he wasn't just overtaken by Alex Breutigam, but also taken now by Marc-Oliver Thiel. Glatter with problems at the moment. And if I'm not mistaken, Kevin Jäger was in the pits. I'm not sure about that. I think Kevin Jäger just crossed that pit entry line before the last chicane, just slightly. And so Matu is just saying he's entering the pits, but he didn't. And René Wagner is already out of the race. There's still pit saying in the overlay, but my tool is telling me he is out of the race. And so let's take a look what happened there. Maybe he hit one of those poles. No, he just hit the wall, spinning out. Out of turn six, he lost the car and he is out of the race very soon. And that really was a bad hit into the wall. Just unfortunate in this situation. Only 20 drivers still going. Sascha Glatter, he's trying to defend, and Marco Drummond is trying to defend as well, because he's under pressure by Kevin Jäger. Drummond now in the Blackhawk Racing Sandwich and watching that fight for sixth position from onboard with Kevin Jäger. He's not carrying any additional ballast. But for some reason still slower than most of his teammates, which is a bit surprising. Because Ulrich, when he's in 10th, Oh, there was some slight touching between him and Marco Domen. Underestimated the slow corner speeds of Marco Domen's Ferrari. Luckily, nothing bad happened to those cars. They are quite sensitive, but some slight touching is still okay. But David Jäger, Alex Bräutigam and Sascha Glatter, they are all carrying additional ballast. But still quicker at the moment than Kevin Jäger. So I wonder where that comes from. Maybe he's driving with more aerodynamics, so a higher rear wing maybe. And that of course costs you a lot of top speed on the straight line. And here he missed the exit out of the chicane entirely. I'm pretty sure that was because of that white Ferrari in front of him, who's trying to make a move against Sascha Glatter. Marco Domen currently quicker, and there's a change in the lead. Kim Strohmann loses his first position against David Jundt. And of course, we will take a look at that again. Well, it looks like David Jundt just exited the first corner much better than Kim Strohmann. So that was quite easy. David Jundt now in the lead and Alex Bräutigam closing in. And again, that's so impressive, and that's why he is the current champion and why he is leading the championship. He's carrying 60 kilograms of additional ballast in that Corvette, and he's running in third. No one behind him. The lot of distance, and he's closing into the first two drivers. How on earth is he doing this? He should be running in a huge disadvantage. And instead, he's chasing the first two drivers at the moment. Marc-Oliver Thiel in fourth, followed by Jürgen Münch. And Jürgen Münch is keeping up the pressure against the driver from the Green Flashes team in that quite noisy Ford GT. Behind them, Sascha Glatter is defending his sixth position against Marco Domen. So Glatter, I don't think it's the 30 kilograms that are problematic for him. He's just running on hard tires, so he is slower because of the lesser amount of grip on his wheels at the moment. But of course, that's all strategy. He's just hoping to stay ahead of most of the drivers as long as possible to get the advantage of the better tires in the second half of the race. But we are at the moment only in this race for 11 minutes, so still a long way to go for Glatter. And he definitely can't keep up the other drivers in front. Now Marco Domen with a much better exit, and they're nearly touching, now trying to enter the chicane. Oh, and what's Domen doing there? Domen running very, very wide. He missed the braking spot for the chicane, entirely running out on that airfield. And drops down to 14th position, even 15th. So the standings got a bit out of the order because he was running so wide apart from the normal racetrack. And now he's in 20th position. If I'm right, he lost a lap because of that, because he missed a sector. So he now is a lap down. He was running, he missed that line where you cross for a sector time, and now he is one lap down. Oh boy, oh boy. That's really unfortunate. So let's take a look at that again. So here he was running behind him, and then he just didn't realize where he is. He was just looking to the side, maybe on the car of Sascha Glatter, and he completely missed that there was the corner already. And I wonder if he noticed that he's not fighting for a position at the moment. He's trying to get a lap back now. Driving behind Sascha Glatter. So he actually didn't really lose much of a position on the track, but because missing that one line for the sector, that line between sector 1 and 2, he dropped down. I'm currently in the standing seas in 20th position rather than in 8th. But still, he's fighting. And maybe he's hoping for a correction afterwards. So when he's coming to the stewards after the race and just saying, come on, it wasn't really my mistake. And I didn't even gain any positions. He lost some time against Sascha Glatter after that. So he would try to stay in that pack and maybe he gets his position, his right position at the end of the race. So it makes sense, he keeps on fighting. Oh, but drifting, and I'm afraid this will cause another loss in position. Yeah, that's Silvio Strigler passing him, and now he's in the way. Ooh, that was Felix Heinen, if I'm not mistaken. Nearly crashed into the back of the Ferrari. While he's under pressure by the Porsche of Martin Ulrich. And there was some hard contact for Felix Heinen. And I think that must have caused some at least slight damage to that Ford GT. But Martin Ulrich entering the pits because he, of course, still has to do that drive-through penalty. And I wonder where Martin Ulrich will rejoin the race. And I wonder what car that is. That's the car of Jürgen Münch. So Jürgen Münch had an accident while we were looking at the situation of Carsten Schulze. So let's take a look what happened there to Jürgen Münch. Oh, he hit the tires. So the first one to crash into those tires. And we will take a look at that again. So let's just see that from the inside of the car. So entering the corner, and we are in the slow-mo. Running behind Marco Le Vettil. And he realizes he's too hard on the inside, and then just bang. And I think he can consider himself very lucky that this car is mid-engined. Because I think a Corvette would be, or a Viper would be dead by now. Jürgen Münch in the pits, repairing his Ferrari. And that is looking bad for the Team Kaplan-Sim Racing driver, but because I'm afraid there will be a lot of repairs that have to be done to that Ferrari. Conny Näslund in ninth position now, because of the several problems of some of the drivers. Namely, Marco Domen, because of that running wild in the first chicane, losing an entire lap. Of course, the crash of Jürgen Münch, and now the drive-through penalty of Martin Ulrich as well. So the Swedish sim racer now in the top 10, and he's carrying 50 kilograms in that Corvette. So also some slight disadvantage for him. Trying to chase Felix Heinen. And behind them, that's Marco Domen. Oh, and Heinen drifting. It's Conny Näslund on the outside, coming up to the final chicane. But that Ford GT isn't carrying any additional weight, so quicker in a straight line. Marco Domen is hoping to get the position back. I hope Conny Nesslund noticed that Marco Domen is a lap back in the standings, but I am pretty sure after that race the stewards will give him this lap back. So where he is on the track at the moment, so physically maybe the word is wrong because we are in a virtual world at the moment, so still, so where the car is positioned on the track at the moment, that's the important thing. And if you give him this lap back, he's currently in 10th position ahead of Matthias Weber, the white and blue Corvette you can see behind the Ferrari. Conny Nesslund missing the corner entry in the final chicane and lost a lot of time to Felix Sainen, and now he is caught up by Matthias Weber. Marco Domen in the pits, so maybe he is trying an undercut, getting out of the whole trouble. Jürgen Münch still going, and I guess they put a small new splitter to that car. Often you can see it, but the aerodynamics working again on that Ferrari. Still, I'm afraid he won't get up to top speed as he did before. So most likely he will stay at the end of the field, at least at the moment. There's Marco Domen. Ahead of them, that's Marjan Kodermann, who also served his drive-through penalty. Martin Ulrich, the same, and he's chasing André Geider. I'm a bit surprised about the speed of the Viper driver, carrying 20 kilograms, of course, because of his 7th position on the Nola Motorsports Park, but still, I expected the Dodge Viper to be a bit quicker. And ahead of the two of them, that's Timo Hartmann, the Fat Racing driver, the teammate of André Geider. Conny Nesslund, he's back at the back of Felix Sainen. Closed that gap very, very quick. Now on the chase of the Green Flashers driver again. It's impressive to see how hard these cars are drifting when entering a corner, and that's because of the low aero, because of the very low rear wing. It's because these guys tried to get the cars on quick on the straight line, as quick as possible. I wonder how long Felix Sainen can keep Conny Nesslund behind him. because he's drifting much more than the Corvette driver. Which is a bit surprising, because you wouldn't expect the Ford GT to drift that much, because it's a mid-engine car. So the overall characteristics should be more neutral than the front-engined Corvette. Still, Conny Neslund, it looks a bit smoother how he is going at the moment. Or maybe Felix Heinen, he's struggling under the pressure of the Swedish sim racer. And he's always setting markings on the track, actually, because of that slight wheel spin exiting the corners. Now you can see the car always, there's some slight drifting. And again, leaving tire marks on the track. That's how aggressive Heinen is driving at the moment, but he has to, because he wants to keep that 8th position against Conny Neslund. Again, wheel spin. I wonder if these tires make it to half time. If he keeps on driving like this. Let's make a comparison to Conny Neslund. Well, that's not so easy to see from that perspective. No tire markings there at all by Conny Neslund. But he's going much smoother at the moment. They both running on medium tires, so it's not like Felix Heinen is driving on maybe hard tires and it's okay to let them drift a bit more, because they are capable of that for a longer time. I'm afraid they are not, and that's why probably Felix Heinen will be starting to drift even more when those rear tires will disintegrate more and more. Well, the next drive for Conny Neslund coming up for the final chicane, but it is this additional weight in his Corvette, those 50 kilograms because of his 4th position in the last race. They are keeping him from taking 8th position from Felix Heinen. I'm pretty sure he would be a lot quicker without those kilograms. But at least for one race, that's the price of success in the GT Pro Series. Behind the two of them, there's Lars Novak chasing Matthias Weber. But in front, slight mistake and some slight contact between Heinen and Neslund. Neslund can keep the car on track, but he loses two positions in this fight for 8th position. So let's take a look how that exactly happened. So there's Conny Neslund, but that was a lap before. So here we are. Now on board with Heinen. He's on the inside, and Heinen just steering in. I don't think he expected the Corvette to be there. take a look at that again. So he was on the inside. Einen already braking, and well, you would just simply call that kind of a dive bomb. So he expected Felix Einen to go wide and to get a chance to stay on the inside line, but he moved next to Einen way after the braking spot, and that's generally called a dive bomb. You have to be next to the other driver before you start braking. So I don't think Conny Näslund will have any hard feelings against Felix Einen. But he got a bit impatient there. And now he has to try to fight his way back. At least up to Lars Novak and Matthias Weber. But that's a huge gap at the moment. Further down the grid, there's Martin Ulrich fighting against Steve Grumpelt, the BMW M6 driver. The only BMW M6 driver in the grid tonight. Started from 17th position and running wide in the first corner. So that's an easy overtake for Martin Ulrich. Grumpelt down to 14th. And there is Alex Bräutigam trying to make a move against Kim Strohmann. And he takes second position from the Peakline Motorsport driver. This is just impressive. I know I keep repeating myself, but it just is incredible what kind of performance this guy is capable of. He's running in second with 60 kilograms in that car. Oh, and what's Marian Kodermann doing there? Was parking in the grass. That looked a bit strange. So let's take a look what happened there. So he's coming up for that. Oh, that was a big hit for the Ford GT driver. And that's a smart move he's doing there. He's just driving backwards, just checking where everyone is and not entering the track on the ideal racing line, but entering from the far outside. And that's how you do it when you make a mistake. But he's not entering the pit, so somehow this car survived that heavy impact. And that's an old trick you can find in almost any kind of racing simulation. Try to hit the wall with the side of the car and rather with the back or the front, because you usually won't damage your wings on the front, the wings on the rear. You won't damage your engine if you're lucky. Maybe you won't damage the car at all, or at least the car has a better chance to survive. And it works in nearly any simulation out there on the market. In some it doesn't work as good in others, but it still does. I remember when playing GTR 2 and I lost my Dodge Viper in exiting Radeillon in Spa-Francorchamps, and I managed to let the rear, and I noticed that the car will run too wide and I will hit the wall, so I let the car slide and drift with the rear and hit the wall with the passenger side door. And I lost all kind of pieces of the car, but all four wheels stayed on and the engine was still running. And I'm pretty sure I would be out of the race if I hit the wall straight on. So that's one of those tricks. And that's why Marian Kodermann is still going, even though he's down to 19th position. But that's also because of his drive-through penalty. Conny Näslund closed the gap to Matthias Weber. And that happened quite quickly. While Lars Novak was in the pits, so he's down to 15th. It's the same with Andre Geida. And in Eslon fighting his way back. And currently quicker than Matthias Weber. Both are running on the same kind of tires, if I'm not mistaken. Or is Weber running on the hard tires? It almost looks like, but sometimes it depends on the lightning. And he's running on hard tires, so it's the same strategy as Sascha Glatter. So there will definitely be no tire change for Matthias Weber. We are close to halftime of the race. Still 41 minutes to go. And I guess soon the medium tires will give in at least a little bit. And maybe the hard tires will start to be the better choice than those worn out mediums. And of course we will have to keep an eye on Sascha Glatter in 7th position, because he's also running on those hard tires. So Conny Näslund, slight drift there by the Swedish sim racer. And they're closing into Felix Heinen, who is drifting a lot. And I'm afraid he soon will have to pay the price for that aggressive driving. I guess he might even say after the race that his setup is too aggressive. Watching it from on board. And just let's see coming up for the first chicane. Sadly, we can't see much, so I'm trying to, let's take a look at from that perspective. And counter steering, that always costs him momentum. You can always see those slight corrections when the rear is starting to get loose on that Ford GT. But at the moment he still manages to stay in 8th. And further up the grid there's Marc-Oliver Thiel trying to catch Kevin Jaeger, but that's just over right in this moment because he gets into a drift. Oh, and Timo Hartmann running wide, he's a lap down. Turn 7 and 8. So Marc-Oliver Thiel was close to Kevin Jaeger just for a short moment, but now he has to fight his way all back again. But Kevin Jaeger is closing in to Kim Strohmann. That's a surprise. So Kim Strohmann, for some reason, he was quick in the early stages of the race, and now he's dropping behind more and more. And Kevin Jaeger currently has one of the quickest lap times next to Marco Domen and Jürgen Münch. Marco Domen, because of that one lap he lost in the fight with Sascha Glatter, and of course Jürgen Münch because of his accident. They are down at least one lap. And Kim Strohmann is entering the pits. So I guess he will see a change in the tires. Conny Näslund is in as well, exiting the pits just right now. And let's see if Kim Strohmann is changing tires. I'm pretty sure he will do. Well, we got a perfect perspective that, yes, and the car is pulled up or pushed up. And he's getting some new tires on that Ferrari. So the first driver out of the top 10 entering the pits. As well as Conny Näslund and I think Martin Ulrich, who is also in the pits by now. Conny Näslund rejoined the track on 15th position. Timo Hartmann is way ahead at the moment, but he still has to come into the pits, and he is behind the car of Marc-Oliver Thiel. So that's not a battle for position, because Lars Novak is already out of the last chicane, running in 13th at the moment. And he was in the pits as well, so I wonder if he can manage to stay out for the rest of the race. Currently under pressure by Kevin Jäger. That's not a direct fight for position. Kevin Jäger in third. Just lapping Lars Novak. And Martin Ulrich passes Kim Strohmann after he exits the pits in 11th position. So Silvio Strigler is in. And Martin Ulrich currently running in 9th. So the question is, he had that drive-through penalty. He was in for that, and he also has to come in for a normal pit stop as well. So I wonder if Martin Ulrich will even capable of finishing on a top 10 position. But if I'm not mistaken, he's also running on the hard tires, so maybe just a short splash and dash, and then we just try to get some positions through that strategy. Not much action going on the track at the moment. Matthias Weber trying to close the gap to Felix Heinen. We simply have to wait until the pit stops are all over. And as we know from some of the drivers, those pit stops can come very, very late. So by now only Kim Strohmann, Lars Novak, Silvio Strigler, Conny Näslund, Steve Krumpel, Timo Hartmann, Jürgen Münch, Marco Domen, André Geider and Marjan Kodermann were in the pits. And while we're talking, Joris Scheepwart is out of the race as well. Sorry, missed that actually. And I wonder what happened to Joris Scheepwart. So let's take a look there. That's running through the final chicane. Oh, and yeah, that's obvious. The engine survived, but the left front tire didn't. And that was the end of Joris Scheepvaart. Too much damage to that car. There's that one track most of the sim racers only know because of the simulation GTR and GTR2, and that's Anna Pergusa. And there are also some of those chicanes with those small tire towers. And first there's this mistake by Lars Novak, so we will try to take a look at the move by Silvio Strigler. And Novak... No, that's not Novak. I was wondering because Novak is running a Viper. That's strange, because that's the car of Marc-Oliver Thiel. How on earth is Silvio Strigler passing Marc-Oliver Thiel, who's running in fourth? But Thiel must have some kind of problem. Oh, and there's some fighting going on. Felix Heinen with a move against Sascha Glatter. That was just too much. They both hit each other, and Heinen with the spin. Carsten Schulze managed to avoid a crash with Heinen. And the big winner of that situation is Matthias Weber, who's now up to fifth position. And of course we will take a look at that as well. Just some rewind, and then there you can see Felix Heinen. He was making a crisscross against Glatter, breaking on the inside, and just couldn't make it. And Matthias Weber passing Glatter. And it looks like Glatter lost a part on his car due to that accident. Yes, there he is. And of course we will try to take a look at that as well. And he already lost that part, so that must have happened earlier in the race. And that's why he was down to Felix Heinen, got into that collision. So that's a bit strange. Let's take a look what happened there to Glatter. Why is he revving the engine so high? Well, that looked strange. So now they fixed the car and he is out on the track again. But to be honest, I can't figure out where this happened to Sascha Glatter, actually. Because I didn't see that he lost positions in the first place, and I also got no notice of an accident of him. So, sorry, but I can't tell what happened to Sascha Glatter. The only thing I can say is that he lost a lot of time because he had to repair that Corvette and is now down to 17th position. And that's bad news for Alex Bräutigam, his teammate, because they mostly will lose another few points in the team championship against the Blackhawk Racing White team. Now Glatter fighting with Timo Hartmann. And I'm afraid for Timo Hartmann that Glatter will be a bit quicker. Still Hartmann defending into turn number one. Now Glatter crossing the line. He's now on the inside. Maybe Hartmann trying to make a crisscross, as we saw by Felix Heinen, but That didn't work out. So now Glatter in 16th ahead of Timo Hartmann. But he has to defend on the inside line. Getting into the chicane a bit slower. But he's simply faster at the moment. Further up, there's Silvio Strigler chasing Lars Novak. And believe me, I still can't find the situation where Glatter lost. That hood on his car. Well, no matter what, he's back in the race. But with a huge loss of positions. Silvio Strigler, he was in the pits as well. So was Lars Novak. And Kim Strohmann is back on the track on 8th position. Right behind Martin Ulrich. And Ulrich, he still has to come into the pits. He only had his drive-through penalty. And I think Strohmann should be a lot faster. Ulrich carrying 75 kilograms of additional ballast, and he's running on the hard tires. And I think Kim Strohmann changed those tires on his Ferrari, the medium tires. Ulrich is staying out, but now earlier on the brakes. Ooh, what? There was a mishap by Kim Strohmann, and he has to give that position back, does he? No, he stays in 7th. Maybe Martin Ulrich just thought it doesn't make any sense to try to get that position back now. I'm pretty sure there was no intention behind Kim Strohmann's run through the grass. But if you realize you won't make it around those tires on the right side, you just open the steering and just run over the grass on the other side, rather than hitting these concrete tire towers with the front of your car. Anyway, that means Strohmann up to 7th. And currently he's in the best position of all the drivers who were in the pits. But Marc-Oliver Thiel is in as well. And he finished his tires as well. Taking a look at Lars Novak, but he's way behind, followed by Silvio Strigler, and they both won't be able to catch Marc-Oliver Thiel. So let's take a look at the standings before we might see the final pit stops. So David Yund currently in the lead, carrying 10 kilograms in that Corvette. And he's definitely currently one of the quickest drivers, followed by his teammate Alex Bräutigam. Well, it's not direct teammate, but they're both racing for Black Hawk Racing, of course. Alex Bräutigam in second. Then it's Kevin Jäger, a teammate of David Yund. Who might be trying to catch Alex Bräutigam at the end of this race. 22 minutes to go, and they still have to come into the pits. So it's 3 Black Hawk Racing cars in the top 3 at the moment. Then Matthias Weber in 4th, he also has to come in the pits. But he's running on the hard tires, so he most likely will only do a short splash and dash. So just refueling what's needed and then exiting the pits already. Then again. Then it's Carsten Schulze in fifth. And he's also running on hard tires. And behind him we can already see Kim Strohmann, who should be a lot quicker at the moment because of those fresh tires on the Ferrari. Of course, all those drivers with the hard tires, they will stay out as long as possible because the car will get lighter and, of course, quicker. And if you stay on the same tires, you won't add any fuel before the car gets as light as possible. So we might see pit stops of the drivers with hard tires in the last 10 minutes of the race, or maybe still about 10 minutes for those drivers to go until refueling. Oh, Kim Strohmann running wide, and he has to be careful. I'm not sure of those signs, those braking signs next to the track, if they can be ran over or if they are hard as concrete as well. You would definitely don't want to find out. Further back, there's Conny Neslund chasing Lars Novak. And that's the battle for 10th position. But the Swedish driver with that huge amount of weight in the car, he is making the pass. And there was a mistake by Marc-Oliver Thiel, so they all pass the Ford GT driver. That's unfortunate for Marc-Oliver Thiel because he was so good before the pit stop, running in the top 5, but now he's down to 11th. I wonder what happened to Marc-Oliver Thiel. So here it's... Oh, and he hit those tires actually when entering the final chicane. And that looked weird to me, so let's take a look at that. So he was running behind the car of, is that, that gotta be Bräutigam. And then he was just surprised by his braking spot and tried to avoid an accident. And by avoiding the accident with Bräutigam, he ran into the wall head on, or into the tires head on. And I have to say, he got astonishingly lucky because he didn't lose any parts at the front of that car. And it looks like that Ford GT is still running pretty well. Oh, and who's coming there from the outside? That's a Ferrari. And I think... gotta be Marco Domen? No. It's Carsten Schulze. Carsten Schulze losing a lot of positions because of an unexpected mistake. So what happened? No, it was a pit exit, so he was in the pits and it took him so long to get back on the track. So that's the reason why he's now down to 10th position. Conny Neslund ahead of him. Timo Hartmann behind him, he's a lap down in 17th. And then Marc-Oliver Thiel racing for green flashes after that accident, currently in 11th. And Conny Neslund still putting pressure on Lars Novak. Steve Gumpelt, by the way, out of the race. Oh, and Neslund crashing into the back of Novak. And there is now really trouble in the chicane. Where's Conny Neslund? He's now back in the race And I think Mark Oliver Thiel got involved again. And where did he end up? It looked like he was sent above the wall. So where is Mark Oliver Thiel now? That's totally weird. What on earth? So let's take a look at that as well. So I think we can see that from that perspective. So just give me a second. So here we are. We see that from there. So in the front there is Näslund. In front of that Ferrari of Timo Hartmann. So now Hartmann, and you can see that in the front. Oh, and Näslund was hitting the tires. And then just Nova came back. Mark Oliver Thiel running wide, and he lost orientation somewhere on the track. So running slowly. So this is the day of weird incidents. So let's take a look at that with Conny Näslund as well. And he didn't hit the tires, he hit the wall, and both cars spun out. Oh, and Novak, that wasn't a smart move. Lars Novak just steering into the oncoming car of Mark Oliver Thiel. And that's especially bad because they are both from Green Flashes. Though Lars Novak is running for the second team, Mark Oliver Thiel for the first team. Still. That was quite a lack of communication there. So maybe it would have been a good idea if Mark Oliver Thiel just shouted out, "I'm coming, please don't move." Martin Ulrich and Matthias Weber in the pits, as well as Carsten Schulze. And I think Schulze was in the pits already, so there must have happened something. Anyway, he will lose a lot of positions, of course. Now Silvio Strigler, who was in the pits, is taking positions, and he's taking a lot of positions. And I have to say, where on earth is Silvio Strigler coming from? He made that undercut, that's for sure, but he started from 15th position. He's running in 5th at the moment. Matthias Weber exited the pits. He's not so far away from Silvio Strigler, but they only have 14 minutes to go. So if this is true and Silvio Strigler really doesn't have to come into the pits anymore, well, I'm not sure if he will stay in 5th, but at least he will probably finish 6th or 7th, and that will be a huge jump in positions. As you can see, there are some parts lying around on the inside of that corner. Martin Ulrich, after his pit stop, he is out on 7th position, close behind Matthias Weber. So running on the hard tires in the end helped him a lot. Still, we shouldn't forget that some of the drivers who were quicker than him actually had several problems, and he somehow managed to avoid all of the incidents. And maybe he's even capable to chase Matthias Weber, since Weber is also carrying 40 kilograms in that Corvette. Well, there's the fight between Kevin Jäger and Alex Beutigam. And don't be fooled, because they're both racing for Black Hawk Racing. Kevin Jäger, it's Black Hawk Racing White, and Alex Beutigam, it's Black Hawk Racing Red. And if you believe what Beutigam tends to say after a race, he emphasizes that they always keep fighting on the track, even though they're teammates. And there can be some hard fighting, actually. Still, both of them weren't in the pits. And I'm pretty sure Kim Strohmann is hoping for some fighting in front of him. So he might take back a podium position. But that remains to be seen. Still 12 minutes to go. And as quick as these two guys were going, I don't think they managed to save enough fuel. I wonder if David Yund takes a victory in this race. I'm already looking forward to all those stories he will have to, he can tell us, because it's always fun to talk with David about sim racing, because he has so much to tell about long gone memories and sim racing, because doing it so long, modern technical stuff, and he often looks at it from a more international perspective, because he's running in several international series, or he was driving in international series here and there. But it's always fun listening to him talking about sim racing, and I'm pretty sure he will tell us a lot about his race, maybe remembering all parts where he somehow missed one of the corners or something. Looking forward to that. But until that, there are still some fights on the track going on, and that's Felix Heinen chasing Lars Novak, and Felix Heinen making the move against the Dodge Viper driver. Maybe that slight accident between between him and Näslund caused the Viper to lose some power. Am I right that he is running on different tires on the front and the rear? Maybe it was just because of the sunlight, but maybe is he actually running on... No, he's running on hard tires everywhere, because it looked to me that the front left tire, the markings were yellow. That would be a bit weird. So maybe one medium tire on the front left and the rest of the tires on were hard. That doesn't work. You can change tires on the front and the rear. You can use different tires, but it doesn't work on the sides. So everything's fine. Lars Novak, he has hard tires on all four wheels. And I wonder what those three Black Hawk Racing guys doing at the front, because 9 minutes to go, they were still not in the pits. Are they slowing down? Are they going slower on purpose to make it through without a pit stop? Alex Preutiger managed to do that, but that was in Okayama. That was the first race where he had no kilograms in that car. And that was a track where there were very less, or not very many, top speed sections. And that helped him to win that race because of avoiding the pit stop. But this track here on that airfield in Cleveland, that's something completely different. There's a lot of full speed going on, and usually that drains the fuel much quicker. Breutigam now defending against Kevin Jäger. But of course, Kevin Jäger is taking things careful, because he knows only 8 minutes to go, and he rather takes third position than crashing into a teammate. Okay, and that didn't work out in that way. Oh, Kevin Jaeger wasn't so sure if he would come into the pits or not, and he now stayed out. And David Yund in the pits. So is he already done with his pit stop? That was quick. Yes, just a very short stop. 5 seconds, just added like really a splash and dash. And he's in third at the moment. So where is Kim Strohmann? Kim Strohmann is way behind, and that's also because Kim Strohmann must have hit something really hard. And probably is lucky that he's still in fourth. So let's check what happened there. There he is. Ooh, on that really unfortunate. Oh boy. Losing the car in turn 8 and just like aiming for those tires. But looks like he keeps on going. Yeah. He was moving to the left and right, just checking if there's still some aerodynamics at the front. And obviously he lost that front part of the car, but that small little wing you can't really see that keeps, or that gives the car the downforce that's needed, that's still there because it just overtook Timo Hartmann with that damaged car. So got lucky, but I'm afraid no podium for Kim Strohmann, because now it's Kevin Jaeger in the pits. And he also just stopped for about 4 seconds for that slight, or that small splash and dash. Now already leaving the pits. Where's Kim Strohmann? Coming up to the final chicane. So that's for sure that he will stay in fourth position. His teammate Silvio Strickler in fifth. He manages to stay ahead of Matthias Weber. And there's only 4 minutes to go, so it's looking good for Peak Line Motorsports to finish in fourth and fifth. And that would actually be an impressive job by Silvio Strickler. Now it's Alex Bräutigam, the last driver without a pit stop. And I'm pretty sure he will be slowing down now. Doing some short shifting. And maybe trying to run on a single tank of fuel without coming into the pits. But still will be, I guess, 3 laps after this one. And he has to come into the pits after that lap. So it's not like finishing the race and just stopping the car. He has to come back into the pits. And if he runs out of fuel, he won't get full points in this race. So he has to consider another lap in fifth gear, but that's not the case. He's coming into the pits as well, so it's just not enough for those 75 minutes. And that's pretty sure that now David Yund will take back first position from Bräutigam, and it already happened. But now I wonder if he stays ahead of Kevin Jaeger. Or will the teammate of David Yund take second position? Now Bräutigam accelerating out of the pits, but it's still kind of a long way. But Bräutigam, he takes more momentum out of the pit exit and he is back in second. And he even took about half a second from Kevin Jaeger through that pit stop. Kim Strohmann in fourth. Not much happening. around the Ferrari driver, but there is still some fighting. Matthias Weber trying to close the gap to Silvio Strigler, and behind him that's Martin Ulrich. And of course André Geider, but he's in 14th, he's a lap down, and hopefully André Geider won't try to do anything and make any kind of moves against the drivers in front of him, because they are fighting for 6th position. Martin Ulrich late underbraking into the first corner, and he is trying everything to get that position, but nearly lost the car. Running wide. And Martin Weber just made that crisscross, stays in 6th position. While Kevin Jäger is closing in to Alex Bräutigam again, so this is still not over. David Jund in the lead without any problems, and Kevin Jäger almost hitting the back of Bräutigam's Corvette. Looks like Bräutigam maybe misjudged the fuel and has to go slower to avoid any problems at the end of this race, which will be in 12 seconds. So let's see, where's David Jund? That's the first corner, so that's the final lap. Now Kevin Jäger making the move against Alex Bräutigam on the outside. Or maybe now he's trying to send Bräutigam in to a bad line, but no, that didn't work out. So Bräutigam stays in second. Martin Ulrich. Oh, he somehow can't keep up with Matthias Weber anymore. There was that one shot he tried in that first corner, and that's been it. But Matthias Weber closing into Silvio Strigler, and there will be one more lap to go for them. Kevin Jäger behind Bräutigam. And I'm curious, will Jäger really hold back because it's a teammate, or will he try to attack if he can? Turn 7, turn 8. But that was too late under braking. He missed the corner entry, and I'm pretty sure that's been it. So let's take a look there. David Jund is already through. Congratulations to that victory. Impressive job by the Swiss driver. Alex Bräutigam exiting the final chicane, and he takes second position with a huge amount of kilograms in that car. Impressive job. Third position for Kevin Jäger. There's Kim Strohmann in fourth. Also coming into the final chicane, taking things slowly. There's no need for hurrying up anymore, but he don't will be too happy about that position. Fourth position, of course, that's okay, it's a lot of points for him, but when you start from pole, you want to be at least in on the podium. Silvio Strigler, he's already through, they were lapped down, so he took fifth position. Impressive job by Silvio Strigler. So he climbed up 10 positions throughout this race. Matthias Weber in 6th, ahead of Martin Ulrich in 7th, 8th position for Felix Heinen. Lars Novak in 9th at the end. Conny Neslund finished in 10th. Sascha Glatter, whose accident that must have happened somewhere in between the race. We missed that, and I couldn't find that in my log files. I don't know how he lost the bonnet on his Corvette. So only 11th position. And that will cost a lot of team points for Blackhawk Racing Red. Marco Domann at the end in 12th position. Then it's Jürgen Münch, who will be, of course, especially angry about himself because of that accident that cost him at least a top 10 position, maybe even a top 5 position. André Geider in 14th. Carsten Schulze, and that's interesting. That's something we have to look for for the results in the next race, because he lost that lap by running wide, because he missed that line between the two sectors, and he actually would be one more lap ahead, and I'm not sure which position that would be in the end. Timo Hartmann in 16th ahead of Maja Kodermann. Marc-Oliver Thiel finishes in 18th. I'm not sure what happened there in the end. And Steve Grumpelt out, as well as Joris Schepfart and René Wagner. We saw those incidents. And there's David Yund, the race winner. Did an impressive job. And I'm looking forward to that interview and how he managed to end up with a victory here in Cleveland. We will take a short break and we will be back soon with our podium interviews. So stay with us just for a few more minutes. And we are back with our interviews, and it wasn't too hard to find all the drivers because they were all in the same channel. So it's a Black Hawk Racing triple in the end here in Cleveland, but the most impressive race, of course, by David Yund. David, congratulations to that impressive performance, starting from third, but maybe it was because of you were only carrying 10 kilograms in that car, but still, there was some competition in the front, but in the end, you took that victory, and you took it with a lot of time ahead of all the other drivers. So maybe, I guess, the race was a bit boring for you, wasn't it?
Not really. To be honest, I knew the track from several IndyCar races before, since IndyCar and Kart has been here. But it's totally different with a GT car. I think I can't remember the last time I was here with something else that was one or wasn't one. And to be honest, it's still very hot. I mean, you have like after it's an airport, it feels like you've got you're driving on the motorway, and you're basically searching for an apex somewhere. But it wasn't as easy. I mean, I need to thank my teammates, especially at setup and the rest. I need to get down to it, and started to come together, but in qualifying I'm not a hot lapper, so I was already surprised that I still got like third on the grid. I even checked my lap back again, so I hope it's good. And in the race, still I was like looking for my consistency, and then looking how I'm in comparison with the other guys. And then I noticed that with some good drives and with a good exit, I could maybe get alongside into the braking zone. That's, I think, how I got Sasha, who was also on the hard. So I kind of knew he would probably try to go very long or maybe even finish the race. And then I also got Kim. And then I thought, now I just need to go get the consistency and drive straight laps, 1-1-12s a lot, and get away and start make a gap to have something in some caution in the end, maybe, to work with, since I was still very nervous. And it was at times struggled a bit with traffic. Some people that had incidents came right in front of me back on track, and it was difficult to like navigate and get past them. Maybe some misunderstandings, which was a bit yeah, slowing you down. But in the end, I was really surprised. I think I was so surprised that on the finish line, I nearly pressed neutral into reverse to kill my engine. That wouldn't have been good. But yeah, I was surprised, to be honest, with this pace, even with less weight.
Okay, so, well, a nice surprise in this case with the victory in Cleveland. Well, I would like to ask you about the next race coming up, but we still don't know which track it actually will be, but because there will be held a vote, and it's kind of a surprise to me that this vote is still not going on already. Did you hear anything which track might be that can be chosen, or are you also in the dark as everyone else?
I don't know anything at all. I was like thinking, if this goes on, I'll just pick a track and then re-race it. Maybe some I don't know, Russian roulette or something to get the track. But no, I don't know anything.
I think there should be a rainbow road out there somewhere as a modification. So,
Oh, Mario Kart.
yes, the Mario
There
Kart
is one.
rainbow
Not
road.
there's another one.
So, well, I hope not this one, but it would be fun, of course. But somehow would bring this GT Pro series. Well, I think that Pro we should think about that again if we would use the Rainbow Road. But who knows? So David Yund, 75 kilograms, of course. So no matter which track it will be a tough race in 2 weeks for you, I guess.
I think so. Last time I had 75 after the wet win at somewhere. I struggle a lot since, I mean, car was very heavy. Maybe it was Spa, I'm not sure anymore, but to be honest, if I could pick a track, it probably would be one that had basically no high speed, no big acceleration, long straights, just a very narrow one. So maybe the additional downforce of the weight is gonna help me. Otherwise, I don't see any light at the end of the tunnel.
Okay, so well, it will be a surprise for every one of us. So for me as well, because I also don't know which track can be voted, because I think there will be two or three tracks, but we still don't know. So David Yount, congratulations again to the victory. It's your second victory this season already here in Cleveland, and I thank you for the interview.
Thank you very much, Sebastian. See you next time.
And now coming up to the driver in second position, and what an impressive performance. Alex Bräutigam, 60 kilograms in that Corvette, and in the end, you are in second position. And of course, that means another lot of points for the championship. So, increasing the gap even more to your direct followers in the team championship, of course, a lot of points as well, though Sascha Glatter had some trouble throughout the race. But Alex, how on earth did you manage to be so quick with these 60 kilograms?
Hard to answer. Don't know. I'm driving like every time. Well, the problem is with the weight, you can't pass a good Ferrari, for example, Kim. And I struggled in the start to overtake him until he made a little mistake. And then I had kind of free air, but David was, uncatchable because he was too fast today. So it was not so tense. So it was kind of boring because there was nothing behind me until Kevin overtook Marco Livatier. Then he could close the gap, so that has gave me a kind of motivation to survive the second place. I planned to, well, maybe to save fuel a bit, just to check if I can finish the race without pitting, but I couldn't save fuel because Kevin was pushing and close the gap. In the end, it was close with Kevin. I managed it. But well, yeah, another podium, so good result.
Yeah, definitely. So he will keep those 70 kilograms, but at least some fighting with Kevin. Was it kind of real defending, or were you kind of in contact during the race?
Well, why not? We want to have fun on track, so there was nothing. I tried. Well, I think Kevin doesn't risk too much. because in the end, to crash with a teammate is every time the worst possible moment in the race. So I think he tried. I tried to defend a bit, but well, it was a little bit fun in the end.
Now, is he better? And for you with the second position, considering the next race, I guess you are with David on what kind of track it should be, with hopefully not many straight line top speed parts and more cornering. What do you think?
Yeah, I agree with that. So Le Mans would be very bad. But well, I know that's not a voting. I think the track is already decided. But I don't know which track it will be. So, yeah, I hope it will not be again such a track like today, because I hope I will never race on this track again.
Why is that?
It's not a GT3 track. So, in my opinion, it's interesting because the track is so, it's not so narrow. So you can take different lines, especially down to the corners. But I'm not a big fan of this track. So hopefully there will be a better track next time.
Yeah, it's definitely unusual for GT cars, that's for sure, so I can understand that. Anyway, Alex Bräutigam, congratulations again, second position in Cleveland, and of course a big jump in the championship again, and thank you for the interview.
Yeah, no problem, congrats to my teammates.
Yeah, and coming up to those final teammate here in the stream, Kevin, you just said you were just listening, but maybe just one or two questions. Of course, congratulations, third position here tonight on Cleveland. But it got close in the end by chasing Alex. So are you a bit annoyed that it is third position in the end, or are you happy with the result?
Yeah, I'm very happy on the third place because my pace 2 days to go was really, really bad. I was 1 second slower than Alex or Sasha, and I expected never that I come in the podium.
So I guess it must have felt pretty interesting to be at the back of Alex Bräutigam and even having a chance to make a pass.
Yeah, I was a little bit faster than Alex, but I had in the second last or third last lap, I had the screen freeze and I lost 2 seconds. Yeah, then came Alex out of the pits. I was 1 second behind. A little bit disappointing, but it's okay.
Okay, got a bit unlucky there, but still unexpected podium for you, Kevin Jaeger. So congratulations as well for the third position, and I thank you for the interview as well. So I just tried to figure out a little bit which track it would be, but still I couldn't find any information. So, well, if you want to keep informed, just check out simracing/united.net and then just take a look at the forum in the GT Pro series in the R Factor 2 section. Everything is written in German and English, so I think you will find your way to any kind of information, and maybe you find out which track will be racing on in 2 weeks, maybe earlier than me. So April 2nd, we will be back on track with the GT Pro Series 10th round, and of course looking forward to that. For tonight, we are over with the stream. I thanks for watching. If you enjoyed it, of course we would like to have a thumbs up, and if you didn't so far, just please subscribe, because of course there is more than just the GT Pro Series going on at Sim Racing United, and maybe looking forward to some more attractive racing here on this channel. So hope you liked it, thanks for watching, and have a good night. Bye bye.